Good morning. Welcome to the service of worship at Westminster. We have come out of the world and we are now in a place of worship. And so I'd like to invite us to have a prayer, because the thing is, sometimes our bodies come into this place and our spirits and our minds and our hearts are still elsewhere. So let's have a prayer and invite the Holy Spirit to bring all of us fully into this place of worship this morning. Almighty God, out of the busyness and chaos of the world, we've come in to this ship, this ark, this sanctuary, this place in which we glimpse the throne room of God, even from the battle and the chaos of this earth. God, in this room, our hearts rest in you, our spirits gaze upon your presence, and we can hear, if we are silent enough, the song of the angels. And so come, Holy Spirit, receive from us what we have to offer you, and open our hearts that we might receive from you what you have to offer us this morning, that as we hear your word and respond to it, we might find ourselves caught up with anew the body of Christ and its work on your kingdom. This we pray in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. This morning, I'd like to invite you to sing with us our opening hymn, This is the Day. And you can find this on page 657 of your hymnal, and we'll sing it through twice. Would you please stand?
This morning, we are tackling the third missionary journey of Paul, and we're going to be walking our way through Acts chapter 20, and this is how this missionary journey ends, Acts chapter 20, verses 36 through 39. When he had finished speaking, he knelt down with them and all prayed. There was much weeping among them. They embraced Paul and kissed him, grieving especially because what he had seen, that they would not see him again. Then they brought him the ship. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I'd like to invite you to stand and greet one another with the peace of Christ. As you return to your seats, I'd like to invite the children to come forward for the children's message.
On their way for our puppet show. Oh, there's a pair.
Hello, boys and girls.
Boys and girls.
Eutychus welcomes you. Hello, glad you're here. Would you like to sit down right here for our puppet show? Yes, a puppet show. And actually, if you don't mind, would you sit here so you can face the stage?
Okay, guys, see you.
Okay, so I'm so glad you're here. We're going to introduce two quick characters to you. Are you ready? This fella's name is Eutychus. Do you have a friend in school named Eutychus? No. It's kind of an unusual name. Looks like a friendly guy, right? Eutychus. Can you say hi, Eutychus?
Hi.
Yes. And then this guy's a guy you've heard a lot about. Now, what is his name, Miss Lillian?
Paul.
Now, remember, Paul has been on many, many journeys, and this is his final journey, and he is still finding people that have never heard the name Jesus. Boys and girls, did you hear what I just said? There were some people that had never, ever, ever heard the name Jesus. So Paul had a lot of talking to do to tell the people. So what he did one night, Paul was talking and talking and talking, and it got darker and darker and darker, and you, the people, were still there listening and thinking, oh my goodness, this is a lot to hear. And this one little boy named Eutychus, he was trying his best to stay awake. Have you ever tried to stay awake and it's really tough? Does your head look something like this? And then you try and wake up again and you go like this. And then one last time, you try so hard to stay awake because Paul is talking. Look, Paul's saying all kind of wonderful things. But he got so tired that finally, guess what he did? He actually fell asleep. But Lillian is going to read the little section of the Bible verse that tells you what actually happened to him. Now, this is a true story. This actually happened. Eutychus is on the third floor. He's way up here. He's way up here, the third floor up. And then what happens, Miss Lillian?
A young man named Eutychus, who was sitting in the window, began to sink off to in a deep sleep while Paul still talked longer. Overcome by sleep, he fell to the ground three floors below and was picked up dead.
True story, he actually fell out of the window. How many stories? Three stories. And guys, can I see a sad face? He actually died. He actually died from the fall. But the Holy Spirit, acting through Paul, brought Eutychus back to life. Isn't that a beautiful story? It's a beautiful story. And the people who had never even heard about Jesus or his miracles, all of a sudden, you know what they're doing? Can you do like this with your hands? Oh my goodness, we have just seen someone come back to life. And imagine these people are now saying, please tell me more. Tell me more about this amazing Jesus. Okay, so it's a beautiful story of Paul in a city called Troas. And who's our new little friend we know about? Eutychus. Eutychus, okay? Let's ask God to help us remember this story. Dear God, thank you for the story of Eutychus. Help us to know that we may run into people that have never heard your story, God, and maybe we are the ones that are supposed to share it with them, the way Paul shared your story with so many people, including Eutychus. Help us, God, as we go on our own journey. It may not be a 10,000-mile journey like Paul went on, but we're on a journey just like Paul. Thank you, God, for your guidance. Amen.
Bye. Thanks for coming.
I invite you now to turn to page 413 of your hymnal. And you may remain seated as we sing together all four verses of A Charge to Keep I Have.
To keep I have, a God to glorify, a never dying soul to save and feed it for the sky. To serve the present age, my calling to fulfill, oh, may it all my power. Master.
thy servant, Lord, prepare a strict account to give. Help me to watch and pray, and on thyself rely, and should if I must trust betray,
friends. We are in the third missionary journey of Paul. This is the last week on the last journey. Next week, we're going to be doing the end of Acts, which takes us on Paul's journey to Rome. And then I'll just say a few words about what we know about Paul's life beyond the end of Acts. Where we've been, we have done the last several weeks on the missionary journeys of Paul. So we started with the story of Acts, which doesn't start with Paul. It starts with the outpouring of the Holy Spirit on the disciples. And the church is born in Jerusalem. And so the mission starts there. And the word goes out. And churches start being planted. And it starts with this movement among the Jews. And then it spreads to movement among the Gentiles. And Paul specifically was called, charged to go and plant churches among the Gentiles. And so his home base was in Antioch, and he was commissioned, sent out on his first journey. He and Barnabas went together and founded all of these churches in this little kind of C shape. And then he and Barnabas came back and spent a couple years at Antioch. And then they decided they wanted to go out and check on all these churches, except for he and Barnabas had a disagreement. So they split up. And the second missionary journey, Paul went with Silas and Timothy, and they were planning to retrace their steps, except for the Holy Spirit got in the way, and they ended up making a much bigger circle, a much bigger journey. And so they went all the way across the continent to Troas, and then even over into Macedonia, and then down into Greece. And the second missionary journey ended with Paul planting churches in Corinth and then coming back to Antioch. The third missionary journey, Paul started by, again, retracing those steps, visiting some of the churches that he'd already planted. And if you are looking at the map on the front, Paul starts in Antioch, which is over here, traces his way up, goes to Tarsus, Derbe, Lystra, Iconium, Pisidian Antioch, and then he comes over here to Ephesus. And most of the third missionary journey, as far as a timeline, he spent in Ephesus, because as we talked about last week, Ephesus was a major port city. There were a lot of travelers coming through, and so Paul could rent a lecture hall in Ephesus, preach there for a couple of years, and get the word out to the whole continent that way, instead of having to travel around himself. And that's exactly what he did. He rented a lecture hall, he preached, and he preached for multiple years there, and the word of God spread, as it said, throughout all of Asia. So he, our time in Ephesus ended last week. We talked about the riot of the silversmiths. So if you missed that sermon, go back and listen to it. It's when the silversmiths got upset because the rise of Christianity was bad for business for idol makers. So that was what we talked about last week. And this week, we are talking about Acts chapter 20, which takes us through the rest of this journey. So after the uproar had ceased, he's talking about the uproar of the silversmiths, Paul sent for the disciples, and after encouraging them and saying farewell, he left for Macedonia. Macedonia is the area across the sea. So that's when he goes across the sea there to Thessalonica and Berea and then down to Corinth. So when he had gone through these regions and given the believers much encouragement, he came to Greece where he stayed for 3 months. So Greece is Corinth. That's at the bottom of the journey there. This is also the time period. So the third missionary journey, which is the years he spent in Ephesus in this time period, this is when the letters to the Corinthians were being written. And so he comes down to actually visit the believers in Corinth at this point. He was about to set sail for Syria when a plot was made against him by the Jews. So he decided to return through Macedonia. So he goes back up the land route, retracing his steps. He was accompanied by a whole bunch of people, going back down here, they went ahead and they were waiting for us in Troas, but we sailed from Philippi after the days of unleavened bread, and in 5 days we joined them in Troas, where we stayed for 7 days. So if you're following along in the map, they're retracing their steps back up Berea, Thessalonica, and then they're sailing across to the far edge of Asia, which is Troas. Troas was Luke's hometown. And this is, Troas is the setting of one of the most colorful stories in all of Acts. There are two main stories that come in this chapter. This is the first one. This is also hilarious. It is the funniest story in the Bible, and it is the lasting condemnation against long-winded preachers everywhere. And this is what happened. On the first day of the week, when we met to break bread, Paul was holding a discussion with them. Since he continued to leave the next day, he continued speaking until midnight. All of you who have ever complained about a sermon being too long, Paul did it first. He started speaking to them after dinner, and he kept speaking until midnight. So what happens when someone keeps speaking until midnight? There were very lamps in the room upstairs where we were meeting. A young man named Eutychus, who was sitting in the window, began to sink off into a deep sleep while Paul talked still longer. Overcome by sleep, he fell to the ground 3 floors below and was picked up dead. So if you think your church has ever gone long, you have seen nothing until somebody actually dies from the length of the sermon. That's what happened in Troas. Paul went down, bending over him, took him up in his arms, and said, "Do not be alarmed, the life is in him." So this is characteristic of Acts. What we see here is we see understated miracles. We have seen this all along, actually, right? So we've seen the believers surround Paul after he is stoned and he is raised up. So he's either miraculously healed from multiple bodily injuries or raised from the dead. Either one, it's a miracle. We've seen Peter brought out of prison. We've seen Paul and Silas escape from prison. We've seen all these miracles along, and they are very, very understated. And that's exactly what's happening here. A boy literally falls out of a third floor window, dies, is raised from the dead in a single verse, and get this, this is what Miss Millie didn't include. Then Paul went upstairs, and after he'd broken bread, he continued to converse with them until dawn. He was like, also, I'm not done with the sermon yet. So like, if you can imagine, like, he's on the stage, they're playing the wrap-up music, and he just ignores it and keeps on going. He literally spoke from dinner time until dawn. And he was like, but I'm not done yet. And then finally at dawn, he was done and he left. Meanwhile, they had taken the boy home alive and they were not a little comforted. So every time you think church goes long, just remember, it could be worse. So the thing about this story, and it's funny when we read it, right? It wouldn't have been funny if the kid had actually died. It's funny when we read it like this, because the entire framing of the story understates the miracle that has just been seen in the community. If you and I were in a church service and a kid died and came back to life, that's what everyone would be talking about, right? That would be the headline of how we told about that church service. The miracle would be the centerpiece of the story. In Acts, the miracles, extraordinary though they may be, are never the centerpiece of the story. Because in Acts, the miracles are great, but they are not the main point. And as you see, it's not even the center point of the story here. Paul goes right back up and keeps preaching his sermon because the main point was not the miracle. The main point was the message that was being delivered. And in fact, the main point of Acts, I think, is articulated to us in the very next section that we're going to read. So this is what happens. So this dramatic incident happens at Troas. And then, after Troas, we went ahead, this happens, that we went ahead to the ship and we set sail for Assos, intending to take Paul on board there, for he had made an arrangement intending to go by land by himself. So what happened there, they're at Troas. If you look at your map, Troas is at the far little corner. Assos is about a half inch away on our map. It's close enough that you could walk it. It would be a really long walk, but you could walk it. And what Paul has apparently done is Paul has sent them ahead by ship because he wants to walk it by himself. Now, it does not say why, but it seems to imply that Paul has something personal that he needs to work out in his spirit because he needs to take a really long walk by himself. And we're about to hear what that is. So he takes this long walk from Troas to Assos. He meets up with the rest of the group, and then he gets on the ship. When he met us in Assos, we took him on board. We went to Mytilene, then we sailed on from there. The following day, we went to Chios, and then we went to Samos. And then we went to Miletus, for Paul had decided to sail past Ephesus so that he might not have to spend time in Asia. He was eager to be in Jerusalem on the day of Pentecost. So whatever it is he's working out in his head, he has decided that he needs to be in Jerusalem by the day of Pentecost. Pentecost was a great Jewish festival. It was also the day that the Holy Spirit came and the church was born, but it was originally a Jewish festival, and the city would be packed full of people celebrating the day of Pentecost, and he is thinking to himself, I need to be in Jerusalem by Pentecost. So before he goes to Jerusalem, though, he bypasses Ephesus because he doesn't want to get caught there. He knows too many people. He goes to a town called Miletus, and he sends for the elders of the church at Ephesus because he wants to talk to them, and he wants to give them a message. Now, what's this message? From Miletus, he sent a message to Ephesus, asking the elders of the church to meet him. When they came to him, he said, "You yourselves know how I lived among you the entire time from the first day that I set foot in Asia, serving the Lord with all humility and with tears, enduring the trials that came to me through the plots of the Jews. I did not shrink from doing anything helpful, from proclaiming the message to you, from teaching you publicly and from house to house, as I testified to both Jews and Greeks about the repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus. And now, listen to this. As a captive in the spirit, I am on my way to Jerusalem, not knowing what will happen to me there, except that the Holy Spirit testifies to me in every city that imprisonment and persecutions are waiting for me." So he is going to Jerusalem. He feels very strongly that he is supposed to go to Jerusalem. He also thinks that something very hard is going to happen to him. Imprisonment, persecution, or worse. "I do not count my life any value to myself, if only I may finish my course, the ministry that I receive from the Lord Jesus to testify to the good news of God's grace. And I know that none of you, among whom I have gone about proclaiming the kingdom, will ever see my face again." So he is determined in his spirit that he needs to be in Jerusalem, that something very hard is awaiting them, and also that these people who he's been ministering with are never going to see him again. So he is not 100% sure that he's going to be killed in Jerusalem, but he thinks it is a likely possibility. And what is happening here is we are hearing not only Paul's farewell speech, we are hearing the core of what Acts is all about. Acts is not about the miracles, and Acts is not really even about the individuals. Acts is all about the mission of God, the ministry, the message. The story of Acts is the story of what God is trying to do in the world through people like Paul, through people like Barnabas, through people like Timothy, through people like Peter, through people like all of these characters that come up. The main emphasis of Acts is the mission of getting the word of God spread to the ends of the earth. And accomplishing that mission is not only the main purpose of the book, but it becomes the sole focus of the people who are featured in this book. So this is what he says. I declare to you on this day, I'm not responsible for the blood of any of you, for I did not shrink from declaring to you the whole purpose of God. In other words, you know what? I might not have been perfect, but I did my best. I told you everything I knew. I never hesitated. I spoke when God said speak. I did what God told me to do. And then he gives them these exhortations and these warnings, keep watch over yourself and all of the flocks. He gives them warnings that the church is going to be torn apart. And then he says, and now I commend to you to God, to the message of his grace, a message that is able to build you up and to give you the inheritance among all who are sanctified. I coveted no one's silver or gold or clothing. You know for yourselves that I worked with my own hands to support myself and my companions. In all this, I've given you an example that by such work we may support the weak, remembering the word of the Lord Jesus. For he himself said, it is more blessed to give than receive. And when Paul had finished speaking, he knelt down and they prayed. And there was much weeping among them, and they embraced Paul and kissed him, grieving especially because of what he had said, that they would not see him again, and they brought him to the ship. Now, I want to think about that scene with you for a little bit, because I think that that shows us not only the centerpiece of the book of Acts, but the centerpiece of the life of every disciple who takes a role in this story that is still being told. You see, the Acts of the Apostles is the story that opens the chapter in which you and I now live, in which you and I now play our roles. Acts 28 ends with the message going to Rome, but we know that the message didn't stop from Rome. It spread from Rome throughout the rest of the ancient world. It spread into Europe. It spread into Asia. It spread into Africa. It spread even into North America. It spread even down into Houston, Texas. And of those original communities of faith that were meeting, there are still communities of faith meeting today, proclaiming the same gospel, telling the same good news, filled with the same Holy Spirit, and pursuing the same mission. And what the Acts of the Apostles is telling us is that in our daily life as disciples of Christ, the heartbeat of everything we are to be about is the mission of God, is the message of God. If we want to stand with Paul at the end of our lives, whenever that may be, and say, I have finished the race. I have fought the good fight. I've kept the faith. I have not been perfect, but I have given my all. I have tried my best. I have done what God has instructed me to do. And I end my life knowing that I have given everything for the mission of God. You see, here is the temptation that comes to Christians. Christians, because we are human, come to the gospel thinking that the main point of the story is the miracle. We come to church thinking that the main point of the story is the miracle. We come to God wanting a miracle. And you and I do this at so many points in so many different parts of our lives, because you and I are broken people living in a broken world, and we need miracles to get through. And we come to God saying, I want a miracle for my marriage or for my finances or for my relationship or for my kids or for myself. But what happens is we get stuck on the miracle and we think that the miracle is the main point of the story. And here's the truth of the matter is, believers see miracles all the time. I see miracles all the time. I see God heal relationships. I see God bring people out of addiction. I see God transform lives and change people. I see God do provide the things that we have asked for in faith and in prayer. I see that all the time. And it is never the main part of the story, because what God is accomplishing through the miracles is the mission. And when Christians lose their focus and they think the main point of the story is the miracle, they are taking themselves out of the gospel of the gospel that is told to us in the Bible. They're taking themselves out of the story of Acts. And they are losing their focus on what the main point actually is and the main point should be. A person who is focused on the miracle as the main point of the story sees only what God has done for me and what God has not done for me. A person who's focused on the miracle as the main point of the story sees only what we want to happen right now in this short blip of existence that we are given. A person who focuses on the miracle, the main point of the story, focuses on our prayer in terms of how it gets us what we want and how we pray more effectively to get what we want. But a person who focuses on the mission sees and accepts the miracles of God when they come along, because they do, but knows that all of those are of lesser importance than how you and I are used in the mission of God. And at the end of our lives, we don't say, look at everything God did for me. Look at how God answered all of my prayers. Look at how I changed my prayer so that God could answer my prayer more. We say, look at what I was able to do with the help of God. I have fought the good fight. I finished the race. I kept the faith. And you know what? All along the way, there was grace poured out, because none of us can do it without grace. And all along the way, there were miracles, because we do see miracles in the life of the faith. And yet, if we are characters in the story that is being told alongside Paul, alongside Peter, alongside Barnabas, and alongside all these other great apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ, our focus is not on what we get from God. Our focus is on how we are partnering with God for the kingdom of God breaking out in the world. And let me tell you a secret. That is actually the most satisfying and fulfilling life you will ever live. Did you notice at the end of this, when Paul bids farewell to the elders at Ephesus, they're weeping. They're crying. We think of Paul as an incredibly difficult human being, and in some respects he was. And yet, it seems that people who loved him, who experienced his ministry, loved him deeply, appreciated him deeply. The life that we live, that is full of the mission and the ministry of God, while it is not aimed at personal satisfaction, my friends, is actually the most fulfilling and satisfying way that we can ever, ever, ever live our lives. Now, the interesting thing about sermons like this is that it's not wrong to celebrate the miracles, because goodness, they should be celebrated. It's not wrong to ask for them. Paul came down and he prayed for Eutychus to be raised from the dead. It's not wrong to want to see the miracles in our life. What is wrong is to change our focus so that God becomes primarily miracle worker for us and not king of the kingdom of God, whose mission is spreading through us and through all the nations of the world until the day comes when peace finally reigns. My friends, I suggest this morning that you and I, in our vocation as being members of this story, have within ourselves a unique vocation that in some ways is ancient and universal to all Christians, but in some ways is unique to us. I live out my mission and my ministry different than Paul, because I am a different human being with different gifts and different skills in a different set of circumstances. You live out your mission and your ministry different than I do, because you are a different human being with different skills and gifts and vocations and talents. Every single person on this face of the earth, while united in mission, if they are part of the body of Christ, yet will end up living it out differently. But what we all have in common is, if we are all part of the same body, part of the same community, the focus of everything we are doing is on the mission, is on the vocation, is on the purpose. And friends, if you are still living life wondering what God could do for you next, you are living a more shallow existence than that to which you were called, because you are not meant to focus on the miracle. You are meant to focus on the mission. and your purpose is grander and deeper than you could ever possibly imagine. My brothers and sisters, next week we are going to be going toward the end of the story. We're going to hear about Paul's journey to Jerusalem and beyond. But this week, I want you to think about your own calling, your own vocation, your own missionary journey, your own mission. I want you to think about where your focus is. I want you to think about where the centerpiece of your life is. If someone told your story, would you be focused around what God did for you, or would you be focused around what God enabled you to do for him? Or would you not be focused on that at all? If someone were to write your narrative in the book of Acts, would it show up as someone who, like Paul, could say at the end of their life, I have fought the good fight, I have kept the faith, I have run the race? Or would it be written as someone who said, I can tell you what God did because I asked? Friends, this week I want us to think about our chapter, our story, our role, our vocation. I want us to ask, are we taking our place? Are we focused on what we should be focused on? Are we stepping forward in faith like these great heroes of the faith? Are we running our race and keeping our faith well? Would you join with me in a word of prayer? Almighty God, you've given us all good things. You have invited us into your story. You have invited us into your mission, into your vocation. God, we who live lives that are sometimes just trying to get by day to day, we forget that you are doing greater things through us. You are proclaiming a greater truth through us. And you are bringing about a greater kingdom through us. And so, God, come, forgive us, we pray, when we have focused entirely on ourselves. And instead, free us for joyful obedience. This we pray as we say together the prayer our Lord taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, this is the point in the service that we call the offering. And this is a whole-bodied offering. This is where you get to give your prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness back to the work of God, who entrusted them all to you to begin with. Here's how it works. We're going to give you about 2 minutes. You can either remain in your seat and pray, or you can come forward and kneel at the altar rail and pray. If part of your offering is a tangible gift, you can leave it at the altar rail, or you can put it in the clear box in the back. If part of your offering is an online gift, you can give it at WUMC.com. But however you are to make your offering this morning, this is your chance. And so make it. This is your worship. This is your sacrifice. This is what you give back to God. And so now in your heart of hearts, use this time to give all of yourself back to the God who gave all of himself to you. Would you stand and join with me as we affirm our faith with the ancient words of the Apostles' Creed? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
And I invite you to remain standing as we sing together, God be with you till we meet again. This is on 672 of your hymnal, verses 1-4.
Till we meet, God be with you.
a moment, just two quick announcements. First of all, June 4th, which is in just a couple of weeks, the youth are having a bake sale to raise money. They're going to donate some to veterans, and they're also going to raise funds for their mystery tour, which is a fun thing they do every week or every year. So the bake sale is the way this works. You need to bring cash because they don't have a credit card machine, and you can pay what they ask, or you can pay a whole lot more than what they ask. So if you want to get yourself a $50 cookie, you are welcome to do that, or you can get yourself a $1 cookie. It's up to you, but they're going to have bake sale items June 4th, so make sure you bring cash on that day. The other announcement coming up is summer. We have a kids summer camp starting tomorrow. Pray for us. We are full of volunteers, but we are going to be run ragged with a whole bunch of little kids from Monday through Thursday of this week, so say a prayer for us. But we are still trying to get volunteers for the kids' summer camp that's going to happen July 31st through August 3rd. That is for kids 5 and under, and we need volunteers from 8:30 to 12:30, and so if you have time availability that week, and any kind of aptitude for small children, we could definitely use you. I said this last week. I've had some people actually comment, you know, I don't think I'm that kind of volunteer because I don't work with kids. And the thing is, the best kinds of volunteers are the ones that you don't expect. And so we definitely want, like, the kid-friendly volunteers. But it's fun to have people who don't fit the mold so that the kids can see all kinds of people, all kinds of different people loving on them. And so if you would like more information about what that volunteer opportunity might look like, you are welcome to talk to Casey or myself, and we can see if it's a good fit for you. That camp will be July 31st through August 3rd. My brothers and sisters, receive these words of blessing as you go out into the week. Body of Christ, brothers and sisters, go in peace and go in faith. Go in hope, go in joy, and go in love. And this week especially, go with your vocation and your purpose and your mission burning within you, knowing that the God who has called you to this will empower you and enable you to fulfill the purpose for which he put you here. And so go, filled with the mission of God and covered by the grace of God, now and all the days of your life. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.